Listening Library presents Faultline by Janet Tashjian. Read for you by Clara Bryant and Jason Harris. Take my life, please. Laughter is one of the only things in life you can count on to bail you out of anything. Even when you're grief-stricken, shocked, or petrified, laughter can bring you back to that place deep inside that knows there's life beyond your pain. I remember the day I learned this in my bones. My Uncle Danny had just died, and my mother had spent most of the morning sobbing at the kitchen table. I was maybe 4 at the time, feeling more helpless than usual. My father had brought up some extra chairs from the basement for all the relatives who would be coming in from out of town. I didn't notice when I sat on one that it was missing its cane seat. Plop! I went right through the frame of the chair onto the floor. I didn't cry, I grinned. The shock of the fall was a welcome surprise from all the sadness. My mother burst into laughter at the sight of her little girl sprawled on the rug, smiling, which of course made me fall through the chair again, and again. It was as if I'd waved a magic wand. Before my very eyes, she was transformed from a broken-hearted woman back into good old mom, because of my actions, because of me. Humor was something thunderous from the heavens, with a power to change things in an instant. Of course, bottling something as formidable as lightning is a tricky thing. Trickier still to do it night after night. Most of the time when I'm on stage, I feel like an alchemist, mixing a little bit of this story, a slice of that detail, to come up with a fresh and humorous aha for the crowd to enjoy. But sometimes you fall flat, with a joke so inert, you want to hang your coat on it. Those nights, it's back to the drawing board, pure and simple. Here's what I want more than anything. Not to headline the improv, not to join the cast of SNL. Okay, you nailed me. Of course I want those things. I'd be lying if I said I didn't. But more than those, much more, I want to learn how to trust my instincts. It's the part of comedy I haven't gotten a handle on yet, although I work on those skills all the time, where I intuitively come up with some thought on the spot that binds me and the audience together for a brief moment. I get goosebumps just thinking about it. During each performance, there's some connection with the audience, but I'm talking about the cathartic, spontaneous kind. The search for that link keeps me writing jokes, keeps me auditioning, keeps me hoping lightning can strike. I'm like Ben Franklin in a storm, holding a kite, a key, and a jar, waiting to connect. I bombed last night, I told my friend Abby. The Bob Marley routine, I bet. Becky, it's just not funny. I love that bit. There's no payoff. I was going for something different. Like what? Audience narcolepsy? Abby asked. Tell the one about your mother hosting that drag queen Tupperware party with Delilah. Now that's funny. Well, I was aiming a little higher than Delilah demonstrating her version of the Tupperware burp. Too bad you weren't this funny last night, she said. You would have killed. Abby and I were closer than sisters. Not that I knew what that was like, having only my 6-year-old brother Christopher to compare her to. She and I met because our last names both begin with M, and we were assigned to the same homeroom every year. Sometime in junior high, we discovered our mutual love of comedy and old movies. She was gorgeous. I was quiet. We never would have hooked up on our own. It took something as random as a letter of the alphabet to forge a friendship this strong. Funny how that works. But even after all these years, I still couldn't figure Abby out. She had a crude sense of humor, constantly pulling pranks, laughing at fart jokes, yet woke up at 5 o'clock every morning to meditate. She hated hanging out with a lot of people, yet craved a packed house. She loved to travel, yet refused to apply to colleges outside of San Francisco because she wanted to continue her practice at the local Zen center. My best friend was an enigma even to me. We grabbed 2 coffees in a booth for our usual round of Saturday catch-up at the local diner. We talked about how the comedy scene was slowly turning around, finally. We wished we'd been born 15 or 20 years earlier, when San Francisco was one of the top cities in the country to work, when Robin Williams performed to SRO crowds several nights a week. Back then, Margaret Cho had left home at 16 to hit the road. Now, at 17, we usually had to lie our way into the clubs. The punchline wouldn't even let us in without a parent. Were they kidding? Because we were still learning, no gig was a waste. Not even emceeing shows at the community center, or why. And hope of hopes, A scout for Conan or Letterman might spot us someday and ask us to perform. Although the school year had just begun, the Saturday morning Yak Fest was fast becoming our senior year routine. It never got Abby and me an inch closer to playing bigger clubs, but it reassured us that we weren't wasting our time, practicing into tape recorders and mirrors for nothing, that we actually might have a minuscule shot at being funny for a living. We ordered two more coffees to go, then headed to Union Square for Saturday ritual number two. For years, our school had had a community service requirement for seniors. Most of the other students had volunteered in a church or homeless shelter, but not us. Because Abby had been going to the Zen Center since she was 12, she talked one of the monks into signing off on our outreach program. Our idea, filtered through Abby's love of Zen and our mutual flair for the theatrical, was to get people to be more present, more aware. So we went to various locales in the city and flashed cards with Zen mottos at the people walking by. Are you awake? Are you here or somewhere else? Wake up! And Abby's favorite, wherever you go, there you are. People usually either ignored us or thought we wanted money. We collected $15 our first time out, but once in a while, someone really got it. Those people would look us in the eyes and smile, become more present in their day. This is so much better than calling up bingo numbers at the nursing home, Abby said. I'm almost convinced we are performing a service, I agreed. The last guy shifted right in front of me. I keep telling you, you've got to come to the center, a room full of people meditating for hours. Abby flashed her card and a smile at a mother wheeling crying twins in a stroller. The poor woman looked like she didn't want to be present. Maybe it was the beautiful fall weather or a very conscious neighborhood, but several other people really responded. An old man put down his groceries and asked us about our project. We ended up talking to him for 20 minutes. After an hour and a half, we packed it in. You want to come to the movies with Kevin and me? Abby asked. Going to the movies was an opportunity I'd usually never say no to, but I had two papers to finish. Kevin was a nice guy Abby had met through her brother Billy. I never felt like a fifth wheel joining them. I liked Kevin a lot, but knew not to get too attached to the guys who stepped through the revolving door of Abby's affections. I left Abby in Union Square and headed home. When a woman walked by me carrying a chihuahua wearing a calico bonnet, I took out my notebook and logged the image for future use. Ed Lynch from the next street over walked by too. He had graduated from my high school the year before. Even though we passed each other almost every day, he never bothered to nod or say hello. I had given up trying to be friendly months ago. It wasn't just Ed. When it came to most guys, it was as if I were wearing invisibility sunscreen. It's not that there was anything wrong with me. Okay, maybe I was a bit on the uncoordinated side, too eager to please. But with most guys, it seemed as if processing my presence wasn't worth their time. Friends and family have always described me as two things: smart and funny. Never pretty, never interesting, just smart and funny. I wasn't complaining. Those were necessary qualities for my chosen line of work. But it would be nice to at least register on the attractiveness scale once in a while. Unlike Abby, I hadn't had a boyfriend since Peter last year, and even that was stretching the definition of boyfriend way past anything Webster would have recognized. I had better luck holding the attention of a room full of people in a comedy club than a guy. I couldn't decide if that was good or just plain pathetic. Idea for a routine. In my neighborhood growing up, I was everybody else's invisible friend. I looked at the card peeking out of my bag. Are you aware? I finished the rest of the sentence in my mind. Are you aware that no one is aware of you? I scribbled a quick bit about Zen riddles in my notebook. Just because Abby wasn't going to use them in her act didn't mean I couldn't give it a go. They'd be better than the sex, drugs, and parents jokes that filled the sets of most comics my age. I smiled, thinking about the sign from last year's comedy workshop that I'd hung over my desk at home. If life gives it to you, use it. Being in comedy was similar to working in a giant recycling center. Nothing went to waste. When I first told my mother I wanted to hit the comedy scene, she flipped. Late nights, grades, alcohol, secondhand smoke, blah, blah, blah. It took 2 years of playing local parties and talent shows before she finally let me drag her to the Comedy Stop downtown. One good thing about living in the city, I've grown up bopping around the many different neighborhoods, using public transportation, and always, always gathering material. I started sneaking into teen open mic nights at the local Jewish community center. I wasn't Jewish, so the first time I went, I pinned one of the shoulder pads from one of my mother's suits onto the back of my head for a yarmulke. I found out when I got there, of course, that the men usually wore the yarmulke.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.